Mesdames, Messieurs, aimables audience, chers invités, je vous souhaite la bienvenue à tous à cette nouvelle édition de la journée coaching. Des applaudissements, s'il vous plaît. Comme de coutume, le département de langue et communication organise cet événement annuel qui a pris pour thème cette année entre intelligence artificielle et capital humain, aubaine. Cette 9e édition sera très spéciale et plusieurs nouvelles rubriques vous attendent. On tient à remercier le comité organisateur qui a fourni tant d'efforts pour innover et apporter un nouveau goût à cette édition. Des applaudissements pour vous. Alors, cette année, le planning est très diversifié. Des tables rondes, une pièce théâtrale et une compétition interfilière vous attendent afin de mener à bien cet événement à caractère professionnel. Mais avant d'entamer ces activités, je demande à notre honorable directeur, M. Mohamed Saïdi, de nous rejoindre pour prendre parole. Je vous demande de bien l'applaudir.
Merci, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Salat al-Salam ala Khatib al-Salim. Chers collègues, chers étudiants, c'est un énorme plaisir pour moi de prendre part à cette 9e édition de la journée coaching professionnelle, pour laquelle vous proposez une thématique d'une extrême importance, à savoir en fait, l'intelligence artificielle et le capital humain, sur toutes les opportunités offertes par ces technologies émergentes à plusieurs niveaux. Donc je commence par quelques indicateurs qui ont été annoncés par des bureaux de consulting internationaux, donc tels que IWC, à titre indicatif, donc la contribution de l'intelligence artificielle à l'économie mondiale est estimée à plus de 15 000 milliards de dollars vers l'année 2030. Donc vous pouvez estimer le nombre d'opportunités offertes à travers ces technologies à différents niveaux, que ce soit au niveau bien sûr des postes d'emploi qui seraient peut-être offerts. On dit aussi qu'il y a beaucoup de métiers qui ne sont pas encore connus, qui sont créés par la disruption de cette nouvelle technologie. Il y a aussi un nombre important d'emplois qui vont être en fait détruits, surtout avec l'automatisation d'un certain nombre de métiers, à l'instar, si vous voulez, des voitures autonomes connectées qui vont certainement impacter le métier de chauffeur. Vous avez aussi des chatbots, des robots qui peuvent aussi contribuer à différentes tâches, notamment par exemple à la traduction simultanée. Donc je vois aussi que le métier d'interprète est menacé. Donc que ce soit aussi le métier de traducteur et même le métier de journaliste. On a vu dernièrement au niveau de la Chine deux journalistes, des robots qui présentent les informations, qui cherchent l'information sur l'Internet et qui en fait développent leur contenu et présentent aussi le contenu sur la télévision. Je vois même venir le métier d'enseignant, en fait. Je vois venir aussi des robots. Même notre métier peut-être serait impacté peut-être très récemment avec l'avènement de l'intelligence artificielle, des robots qui peuvent certainement remplacer notre métier. Donc vous pouvez imaginer, vous pouvez ouvrir si vous voulez votre imagination à toute idée innovante. Donc l'innovation est vraiment très importante dans ce domaine. Selon aussi Jack Ma, le président fondateur de Alibaba, que tout le monde peut-être connaît, on a aussi un impact très important au niveau compétences, qui seraient en fait les compétences ciblées, sollicitées dans le cadre de cette nouvelle révolution. La première révolution a commencé il y a pratiquement une trentaine d'années avec l'avènement de l'Internet. Et maintenant, on assiste à une nouvelle révolution qui est bâtie sur l'avènement de l'intelligence artificielle. Alors, en termes de compétences, là aussi, je crois qu'il y a un grand challenge, un grand défi au niveau des institutions de formation qui doivent suivre d'une façon continue, qui doivent anticiper, doivent être proactif par rapport aux compétences exigées par ces nouvelles technologies. Donc, selon Jack Ma, les vraies compétences qu'il faut citer sont les compétences soft, les soft skills, c'est-à-dire la communication, le management, le teamwork, l'adaptation et la possibilité en fait d'être dans la dynamique et dans la logique de lifelong learning, c'est-à-dire il faut être ouvert à suivre des formations continues. Donc il faut bien sûr préparer les étudiants à s'auto-former. Donc là aussi, je crois, même au niveau des approches pédagogiques, il faut faire un effort pour adapter notre façon de faire en tant qu'enseignant, en tant qu'institution de formation, bien sûr, pour s'adapter à ces nouveaux défis. Donc, je tiens vraiment à saluer tous les organisateurs de cette journée, notamment l'équipe du département langue et communication de l'ENSEAS, son chef département, Madame Zahid, Madame Hassan qui n'est pas présente avec nous. Et je salue également l'effort de tous les étudiants qui ont contribué à cet événement. Et je suis aussi très content de voir notre ami Tani, qui est maintenant, je crois, un membre officiel de la famille ENSEAS. La part de sa participation continue dans cet événement et dans d'autres événements organisés à l'ENSEAS. Sans tarder, je vous souhaite une excellente journée et je passe la parole au modérateur.
Joining us here today. We are here to celebrate the 9th edition of ENSEAS's Coaching Day, an event and also a tradition initiated by the Department of Language and Communication. I would like to take a moment to express my appreciation for this whole department, the teachers, and more especially the head of the department, Mr. Faizi. Please, a round of applause. Before we dive in, first of all, we're gonna all welcome one of the founders of this event, Madam Zakia Abdulrahman, which is also our teacher. She's gonna give us a welcoming word for this event.
Okay, thank you. Welcome everyone. It's a great day that we celebrate today. We are at our 9th edition. So first, please join me to welcome our guest speaker that I thank too much, Professor Huda Bakali, Professor Hassan Kitani, who accepted to come and to share with us their experience around the artificial intelligence. Great thanks to all our colleagues, our students, and also the great thanks go to the organization committee of second year students who were behind the realization of this day. And we would like to thank also Jihan, yes, who did a great work. Please applaud Behan Jihan, okay? Okay, so please, the 9th edition day, the edition of the Coaching Day is an event that serves for our students to get in touch with each other, because as you know, at ENSEAS, everyone is thinking about the hard skills. But our hope is that when our students get engineers and would like to go to the market of work, we would like them to be armed with some soft skills. So these events help them to get into touch with each other, so they will get a leader in the market, so they learn along this activity and this experience how to become a leader. They learn many things, how to work into a team, because they spend many times negotiating, choosing the topic, organizing the activity and every time. And along this preparation, the students gain their self-esteem, their confidence, their sense of leadership, and along this coaching day, we would like to teach them how to brand themselves, that is self-marketing, how they have to sell themselves, and this is what we will have in the afternoon. We will have some session with some recruitment offices that will come, and we will have some job simulation or interview simulation and the CV correction. I think I don't want to speak too much. So I would like to thank everyone who participated in the success of this event. I thank Mr. Saidi, who is always behind us and help us. I thank Mr. Faizi, the head of the department, who helped us in organizing this day. I thank also all my colleagues of the department, and thank all the professors and students of INSEAD. And welcome, thank you for attending this session.
Merci beaucoup, madame, pour ces jolies paroles. Et maintenant, place à l'intervention de madame Bumbrahim Mouda, professeure du département informatique et aide à la décision de l'INSEAS, pour discuter du thème Overview of Cutting Edge AI Technologies, Application and Challenges. Des applaudissements, s'il vous plaît.
Okay, so hello everybody. Okay, so hello everybody. It's a pleasure to be among you today for the ninth edition of the Kelly Martin Shadak.
Another time, hello. So hello everybody, so I'm really pleased to be among you today for this coaching day. So for those who doesn't know me, who don't know me, so I will present myself. So I'm Huda Bumbrahim, I'm a computer science professor here at NTS. So actually I hold a PhD, I hold a master degree in computer science with a major in artificial intelligence in 99. I'm not that much old, but it was in 99. Then I go to Atala Khawen University by the time. Then later I go to PhD from Portsmouth University in England in artificial intelligence as well. So my research interests are in the area of artificial intelligence, machine learning, data mining, text mining, big data analytics, intelligent systems, fuzzy logic, and so on. So I'm a professor here at ANCIA, so I joined in 2009, but before joining in September 2009, I was first a lecturer at Al Khawen University, teaching computer science courses. Then I went to UK, so I was also not professor, but also a lecturer at Portsmouth University. Then I worked also as a consultant, data analytics consultant at Ernst & Young at London offices. Then I came back on 2009 for a position here at NTS. So today's talk is going to be about artificial intelligence, cutting edge technologies, applications, and challenges. So actually, nowadays, we can notice that everybody is talking about AI. But AI is not a new word, so it existed since for decades. What makes it hot topic those days is the advances in several elements. Mainly, it's data. So we can notice that now data is available. It is everywhere. So this is because or due to mobile phones, sensors, web, social media, and so on. So this is the first. Second, so because of the advances of computing in storage, in computing, in processing, and so on. And the third point is the advances in algorithms. So this is why we can hear nowadays a lot about artificial intelligence and so on. But as I said, it existed for decades now. So today's talk, so I won't talk about those elements, but instead I will talk about the applications and related challenges of those applications in terms of AI. And since today is the coaching day, so I will talk about some jobs in AI and the skills needed for AI and so on. So let's start. What is artificial intelligence? So as I said, artificial intelligence existed for decades now. But at the beginning, when we were young, when we hear about AI, what do we have in mind? AI is about what? A few years back, you were still young, 10 years, 15 years. I think it was about that. Fiction movies, for most of us, I think. And for the others, who doesn't believe that AI is just about fiction movies, I think it was about robots. But is that true? Is AI just about fiction movies or robots? I think it's much more than that, okay? So, as the father of artificial intelligence, John McCarthy, so he said that artificial intelligence is the science and engineering of creating intelligent systems, but especially intelligent computer programs. And since then, so there has been really several definitions for artificial intelligence. And I won't cite all of them, yeah? But they all share something that says that artificial intelligence is the process of designing systems that try to mimicking the human behavior. So, as I said, several definitions, but mimicking, we're all time trying to mimic the human behavior. So what is the human behavior that we're trying to mimic? Humans listen, talk, perceive, think, take decisions, feel. What else? Perceive. Did I mention everything? And so on. So this is humans. So now with artificial intelligence, we're really trying to model those things. How to speak, how to understand, how to perceive, how to take decisions, and so on. So this is AI. So artificial intelligence actually is about that, okay? So as I said, because we have to take decisions and so on, so in artificial intelligence, we are having so many subfields. So we can, but this is not an exhaustive list. This is just, so we're having machine learning. And in machine learning, we're having other subfields. So we're having deep learning, we're having supervised learning, we're having unsupervised learning, we're having reinforcement learning, we're having semi-supervised learning, and so on. In AI as well, we're having natural language processing. This is the main, among the main subfields of artificial intelligence. So in natural language processing, so we're having content extraction, classification, machine translation, question answering, text generation, and so on. Again, this is not exhaustive. They are just few examples. We're having also expert systems in artificial intelligence. We're having also vision. We can talk about computer vision, about image processing, and so on. We're having speech. Speech to text, text to speech, so those are among the subfields of AI as well. We're having planning, and of course we're having robotics. Okay. So this is AI trying to mimic the human behavior. We have seen the AI different fields and subfields and so on. So now we will move on to the applications. So nowadays we can notice that artificial intelligence is everywhere, okay? It's everywhere. You can take your mobile is just full of AI applications. So we're having face recognition, we're having some traditional or standard applications, for example, gaming, chess, video games, autonomous cars, image recognition, speech recognition, education, artificial intelligence in education, in security, for social networks, so Facebook and so on, they are really doing lots of AI behind, using our data, of course. Smart cities, what else? Industry, smart transportation, energy. So you can see that AI now is really everywhere. So actually, AI doesn't stand by itself. So AI, it is added to actual applications, to existing applications. So we won't find an AI stand-up application. No, AI, it is included in existing applications. So AI adds intelligence to existing products. AI will not be sold as individual applications. They are not stand-up applications by themselves. They are just included, embedded in existing applications. Products you already use will be improved with AI, and this is the nice thing about it. And now we can notice that AI adoption is accelerating. So actually, so statistics say that 94% of companies believe that AI will improve their business. Now, so this is just a recent study, so they say that 25% of companies have already adopted AI, and by 2021, so it's gonna be really 75% of companies that will adopt AI. So this is really good, and AI adoption is really accelerating. So now we will, so this was just an overview about AI and things, so now we will go on to go through some specific applications. Of course, so as I mentioned, so AI is used everywhere. We won't have enough time, so we need really weeks maybe to go through all the applications and challenges. So I have just picked some few, okay, applications. AI in education. We are at NCS, okay? So how AI can change the education system. So we can talk about smart content. How? So AI tools can condense content of textbooks into more digestible study guide. AI can help tutor students and provide real-time feedback. I won't go through all of them. AI can monitor students' answers to questions and help identify which concepts the teachers need to readjust. So you can say that the applications are really amazing, just, and they all go into helping or improving the quality of education. AI systems can help grade homeworks. We need that at NCS. Grade homeworks, evaluate essays, and measure student responses. So really interesting applications in AI, the education. So we're having also AI in sales. So we can just really increase the benefits of the company by adopting AI. So we can have, AI can record, for example, meetings and calls, capture time, stamp notes, obtain transcripts, and highlight key references. We're having also, can see, AI can assist with faster responses to individuals inquired about products and services, and so on. So, here it is again. So AI is really actively used for sales, and it says that it will increase really the benefits of companies. AI in manufacturing. Okay, so now everybody talks about Industry 4.0, so this is it. Okay, so the main or the major application is that we're moving from reactive manufacturing or manufacturing in general, sorry. So for manufacturing, so we're having so many things, detecting faults, we're having also maintenance, so we can use AI for the maintenance. So far it was about responsive maintenance. That means that once we have a failure, then we will intervene to solve the problem. Then we move to predictive maintenance. That means that using AI, so we can just predict when, for example, a machine will fail, then we will solve it. But now it's much higher than that. It's really proactive. It's not even predicting. So we're proactive. We're acting proactively. That means before even the fault will occur. It's not even predicting when it will fail. It's predicting the maintenance before it happens and so on. So this is really good. In manufacturing also, we're having optimized supply chain. We're having create safer work place, for example. So instead of having tasks, for example, that are difficult, so we can just use AI that can handle those tasks and so on. We're having also AI in advertising. In advertising, so we can say that AI tools can assess brand's voice and generate optimal and copy through enhanced profiles. We can talk about conversational interfaces, can interact with prospects, and so on. And here, for all of those applications, you can notice that it's not just one field that is used. It's not just machine learning that is used. It's not just deep learning that is used, but all the other things. It's about natural language processing. It's about machine learning. It's about computer vision. It's about so many things. AI in mining. So now AI is widely used in mining, and OCP is doing that as well. So mineral prospecting and exploration, self-driving haulers in difficult areas, so that the workspace will be safe, improve safety, digital mine, automating geotechnical inspections, and so on. So here it is. So this is just an overview, just to give you a feel that AI is really used everywhere. In every single application. AI in IT service management, chatbots. So instead of having someone, for example, that just answers your problems with your computer and so on, so we can just have a chatbot, right? You can just give him questions about your problem, it will answer you and so on, chatbots. Automatic ticket assignments, predictive maintenance, and so on. AI in healthcare. So now AI is really has been present strongly in healthcare. So we're having robot assisted surgery. So now we're having really surgeries that are done by robots. So there is 90% of AI behind it. We're having also virtual nursing assistants. So instead of having a nurse, so we may have just robots. AI behind, okay, that just assists, that will take care, for example, of patients 24 hours a day, seven days a week. We're having also administrative workflow assistance. So there are many statistics, and they said that the time of nurses, it's more than 60% of the time of nurses just goes into administrative tasks, not taking care of patients and so on. And they said also that 20% of the time of doctors just doesn't go for patients, but goes for administrative things and filling papers and reports and so on. So AI can just play a big role in that. We're having also fraud detection, for example, for billings, for hospitals and so on. So they use AI for billings. We're having also error reduction. So everybody knows about the errors that doctors just make. Okay, so we can just reduce the errors by using AI that will help, for example, the surgeon and so on, so that they won't make wrong diagnosis, for example. We're having also connected machines. We're having also clinical trial assistants. We're having AI assisted diagnosis. So nowadays, so AI is widely used in. Radiologue. For radiologists, okay? So now they said, for example, for a radiologist, how many scans, for example, he can check during all his professional life? 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, right? For AI systems, they can just process, you know, millions in less than few hours, okay? So really AI is playing major, starting to play major part in medicine, in healthcare. And it's not just that, it's everywhere. Okay, so those are just news highlights. So AI helps diagnose depression earlier by analyzing Facebook posts. Just from Facebook posts, as I said, social media are just using, you know, your data, and they are doing lots of AI behind. And from your post, they can detect if you're having depression. Okay, artificial intelligence learn deep thoughts by applying Pictionary. Brain-computer interface breakthrough translate through into speech. Bowel cancer patient recovering after very robotic double surgery. So, and it is a really critical operation, and it just went well. AI is acquiring a sense of smell that can detect illness. Just from smell, we can detect that a patient is sick or not. So this is really good. Do we have any practitioner, any doctor that can do that from your smell? I don't think so. So here are some real applications of AI and how they are really improving the quality of life of people. Google AI can predict when people die within 95% of accuracy. I won't try this. What else? China creates AI news readers who can work 24 hours a day. Dr. Saidi just mentioned it. Yes, it is in the news as well. Netflix password sharing may soon be impossible due to new AI tracking, and so on. So the list is really very long. So you can notice that AI now is everywhere, and it is really solving some very interesting problems. And the most important thing is that it is improving the quality of life of people. So now let's go to challenges. So as I said again and again, just an overview of AI applications. We can just go through all of them. So now let's go to challenges. Do you think that this is easy? That AI just solving all of those problems easily without any challenges? No, there are so many. Okay, among them we're having trust. I mentioned earlier for example, that AI can diagnose depression beforehand. But once, for example, you're diagnosed with that, will you trust this diagnosis? No? Not really, right? Why? What else? AI is acquiring a sense of smell that can detect illness. If from your smell, so we just say that, okay, you're sick and you're having that, will you trust that? So AI is really facing this trust problem. Are people trusting this? Why? Because usually we humans, and this is psychology and so on, so if we are out of our comfort zone, we just don't like it, okay? And because we don't understand AI, we don't understand how it works, we don't understand how it comes out with this decision or this result, so we will just not trust it. Okay, so this is among the things. So trust, building trust, this is important, and this is among the challenges of AI. AI human skills. So you have noticed that AI is everywhere. You have an idea about how many AI skills do we need? Now AI is everywhere, right? So we're having shortage of skills. So we need really people, students, doing AI. machine learning, and so on. Okay? We're having also data, and this is really very important. So I don't want to go through details because this is there's a lot to talk about that. But for data, so you know that AI algorithms are built using data. So assume that your data is not of good quality. Assume, for example, that your data is biased. Assume that your data is not trusted. How is going to be our models? How are we going to predict? Are we going to have good models? Are we going to predict really good? No. So we need really some good data to be able to have good models, to be able to have good applications, and so on. We need also investment. Okay, so AI is an expensive technology and not all businesses can afford it. So we're having this challenge as well. The other thing is that AI can replace only some few tasks. Of course we still need humans. Of course there are some tasks that humans are really good at, but AI not yet. Okay, so but the problem is that, for example, many of us, because we don't know what is AI, we don't know what are the limitations of AI, so everybody thinks that AI is just baguette magique that can just solve whatever problem. This is not true, okay? And also high expectations. So we just expect, for example, that AI is just accurate, it just one, it's not that, okay? So those are the major challenges of AI. So now, how those challenges will impact the different applications? We mentioned trust, we mentioned the quality of data, we mentioned the investments, we mentioned so many things, right? So let's see how those challenges will impact the different applications. Would you let a robot perform your surgery by itself? It's about trust, problems, challenges. New technology widening gap between world's biggest and smallest firms because of investments, as I said. We need to invest. It requires a lot of money. Small companies can't afford that. So we're just having a big gap between big companies and small companies. AI tricked into thinking a turtle is a rifle and a cat is a quagmire. So this is because of the quality of the data. So we tried, the model is really good, but because of the quality of the data, so we just did that. And AI is accelerating, but is healthcare prepared for it? Can we just do it now? Yeah, there are a lot of applications and so on, but because of trust, because of investment, because of so many things, we cannot really adopt it right now, fully adopt it. We're having also self-driving cars more likely to drive into black people. This is bad, because of the data that was biased. Okay, and so on. What else? This man was fired by a computer. It's a program, it's a computer, decision making, and so on. It says that it should be fired. This is a problem. So better AI could have saved him, and so on. So those are the challenges that we're facing with AI. So this is why we have to work on trust, on data, and data, and data, okay? And money, of course. So now, is artificial intelligence an angel? It is good for everything. No bad side. Everything is fine with AI? Of course, no. Yeah. So, AI can secretly be trained to behave maliciously and cause accidents. So we can just tune the algorithm. Insurance companies maybe later on because of the autonomous cars and so on, they can just tune the program so that the autonomous car will make accidents. This is bad. So it's not an angel. Killer robots from South Korea University boycotts. So here we're facing killer robots. It's not just one. So everybody is talking about killer robots and this is bad. Killer robots must be banned before it is too late. Killer robots must be banned, hundreds of experts warn, and this is serious. UK government developing flying killer robots. This is scary. And there is Ali Jack Ma who warns evolving technology could cause World War III. Bill Gates who say that AI is like nuclear energy, it have advantages and disadvantages. What else? So we're having also Elon Musk, the Tesla car and X-Space and so on guy. So AI is highly likely to destroy humans and so on. So we've seen AI, different applications, the good side, but also there is a bad side of it. So how can we have good artificial intelligence applications? How can we have that? So the development and adoption of relevant international standards and safeguards to bring the benefits of AI, because we've seen the different benefits of AI if we just include them in every application, so the improvements that we can have. But we should promote legal, ethical. Everything is about ethics, private and secure use of AI. Allow also machine learning to be ethical, so everything is around ethics, okay? I'm an AI engineer, instead of designing something that will harm, so I will just switch and think about something that is useful. And the other thing is the adoption of data sets that are accurate and representative of all. So we've seen some challenges, right? And we've seen that this is due to data, to the bad quality of data that is not representative of all the population and so on. So we have also to work on the data. So this is just a trial, right? To have a good artificial intelligence. Yeah? So now, so today is about professional coaching, okay? So the impact of artificial intelligence on the job market. So this is our day. This is bad. Will robots take our children's job? Robots will drive us to rethink the way we work. Women are being pushed out of workforce by AI and job automation. Intelligent machines will replace teachers within 10 years. I think that we have to think about another job within 10 years' time. What else? AI will be better than human workers at all tasks in 45 years. Bank of England economists warns thousands of jobs at risk from robots. This is scary, isn't it? We will be jobless. Oops. But don't worry. Be happy. Okay, we won't be jobless. That's true that we will lose, that we will suppress some jobs, but new jobs will be created. Okay, so multiple layoffs, what do we have? We have telemarketing, bookkeeping, insurance calculation, receptionists, proofreaders, and so on. So all of those jobs will be affected negatively by AI. They will be just suppressed because AI can just do it. I can do it really perfectly. Can be automated intelligently, and the proficiency and profit margin in all of those sectors will improve dramatically when handled by AI. But the new thing is that with AI, we're creating new jobs. What happens? So AI will replace a number of human jobs, but still it will create new ones. So this is a good thing. It's been predicted that by 2020, AI will be creating 2.3 million jobs and will replace close to 1.1 million jobs. So there is still room for AI engineers and so on, okay? The impact also is that workplace safety will increase. Assume, for example, that we are at mining site, for example, and so we can just have robots or autonomous haulers and so on to drive, and by doing so, we will have safe environments to work. So dangerous jobs will be handled by AI and not humans, and this is a good thing. Oops. AI. Zekeriya, we need AI for that. To predict when it will start. And act proactively before the fault happens. And we're having also some specialized jobs, is that entirely new jobs profiles for humans will be created. So don't worry everybody, we will have a job. including teachers. So, what are the artificial intelligence needed skills in the job market? I say it, it's about math and math and math and statistics. Okay, so this skill is really needed for AI engineers. We also need programming and databases because we're dealing with data, right? So it's not just about math, but it's about everything. Data and databases and Hadoop and tanks, big data, infrastructure. We need also communication. So Hassan Kitani will talk about that later on. Because we are engineers, we are good in math, but if we just don't communicate well, how can we explain, how can we perceive the needs of our customer, how can we display or give the results of our study, for example, to our customer, and so on. So we need communication skills, able to engage with senior management, storytelling skills, this is also important, translate data-driven insights into decisions and actions. As I gave all time to my data mining students, so we're having the business problem, right? But we have to map it into a data mining, into machine learning problem. How can we do that? We have to have this skill as well, and so on. We're having also some domain knowledge and soft skills. We need soft skills. We need people who are passionate about the business, who are passionate about improving the business, people that are passionate about the business, who are curious about the data, because all of that we're going to construct it through data. So we need really data engineers as well. Problem solvers. And this is very important. It's not just about math and statistics, machine learning and stuff. It's also about problem solving. We're having some problems, how we're going to solve it. Yeah, the tool is going to be machine learning maybe, but we need these problem solving skills. We need people who are strategic, who are proactive, who are creative, and this is very important. There are some really AI, many AI applications that you can just think, right? We need that skill. Innovative and collaborative. So those, are, in general, are the skills needed for an AI engineer. So the job market, several companies, 100% dedicated AI, 200 companies for just machine learning, worldwide, of course, okay? 100 companies for just computer science, computer vision. This is really interesting. What else? NLP and speech recognition. NLP is more than 200 companies, 100% NLP applications, virtual personal assistants. Anyway, this is just to let you know that jobs are there. Just work hard. Math and math and math. What about the Moroccan job market? So this is a call for projects in Morocco. That means that Morocco is also interested in artificial intelligence. And two ministries are just taking care of that. So it's Ministère de l'Education et l'autre de l'Industrie. C'est bon? They are really interested in artificial intelligence and they are funding projects. Giving money, that means what? The field is really interesting, okay? And in which fields? Everything. Agriculture, industry, smart cities, computer vision, energy, healthcare, finance, it's everywhere, okay? So all the fields are really funded by the governments for AI applications. And this is it.
Just to give you the feel, you know, of the feel, artificial intelligence.
All right. Thanks again, Madam Rahim, for your insightful presentation. If anyone of the end of the audience have any questions or anything, please.
First, thank you very much for your very, I know I learned a lot about artificial intelligence. That's something that that is scaring for me. Now, I have just one question, because I recently read an article about recruitment, and you talked about one way to improve artificial AI is to look at the data, to be sure of the data. Now, this article that I read, it talked about Amazon, which relied on AI to recruit people. Yes. Now, the problem is that 90% of the people it recruited were male. Males, just males.
Yes.
And then it was, they found it a little bit funny. So they, when they looked at it in more depth, they realized that the AA application was developed by men, of course. And this made it a little bit biased, because it defined women as being inferior. So it recruited just 95% of the people who were just males. Yeah. So this is just going back to what you said, data. But again, sometimes even without realizing it, the data can be biased.
Yes.
So this is my question, and it is a little bit scary, because to some extent, to what extent should we trust? You talked about trust as well.
Yes.
But then even we trust, and even sometimes it can be done without realizing it. Yes. So this is...
Thank you for your very interesting question. So it's somewhat AI challenges. Okay, as I said, AI is not magic, right? So we need trust, we need data. The problem is the data. If data is biased, of course, by the end, so we will have a decision-making system that is biased as well. So we have to work on that. And the other thing is, it's about machine learning algorithms. So this is why research in machine learning is still alive, right? So we're working on that. Biased data, what we'll do? Shall we just design new algorithms that will handle this biased data and so on? Yes, because still AI systems are not 100% accurate. No mean. Okay, so we're working on that. The AI community is working on that, on improving the quality of the systems and so on. But this is very real. Yes. Yeah. This is the bad side of AI. Yeah, so there is the good side and there is the bad side. They are working on the bad side, right? Through data, through creating new algorithms that are not sensible to biased data and so on. So, but the other thing is that AI, that's true that it has been there for decades, but real applications, because before that it was just in laboratories, we were just designing algorithms and stuff. But now we can see some real life applications. So we can just say that the real life applications in AI, they are still in their infancy, right? So they still need to be improved, to be tuned and so on. Yeah, but among the challenges and the bad side of AI.
Dire faire ou bien lancer des recherches, bien lancer des projets, connaissances de notre domaine. Mais chaque fois, ce sont eux qui disent, mais attention, voilà, il faut faire attention. Alors, on entend que, par exemple, le patron de Facebook n'a pas du compte Facebook, on entend que, bon, il y a ceci, etc., etc.
I don't have Twitter.
Est-ce que, voilà, cette duplication de langage, bon, est-ce qu'il n'y a pas du commercial derrière?
Sure.
Et de deux, c'est-à-dire votre présentation, je ne voudrais jamais juger du problème. Pour moi, ce qui manquait, c'est la partie politique. C'est-à-dire ce que pensent les leaders politiques, ce que pensent les chefs d'État, etc. Sachant qu'actuellement, on le voit très bien, le Parlement, il y a un changement du point de vue paradigme politique. On va plus vers un peu plus de démocratie. Pas la démocratie, pas la dictature, la démocratie. Vu les différents leaders qui émergent. Est-ce que l'intelligence artificielle ne risque pas d'être un outil pour plus de domination de la part
de manipulation, c'est sûr. C'est sûr.
Par rapport aux opinions publiques,
c'est
par
sûr.
À l'ambiance,
c'est sûr.
Je trouve que peut-être là aussi, ça pourrait être un axe à investir à ce niveau-là.
Merci, merci Monsieur Bounabit pour votre question. Donc vous avez posé deux... Je parle en français. Okay, so you mentioned two points. The first one is about the leaders of AI companies and so on. They are the ones who are warning people that they are saying that AI is dangerous and so on. It's because they know what it is and they know the capabilities of AI. They know how we can manipulate AI, how we can just tune it, you know, just to do the bad things. So this is why they know. Normal people, I don't think that they know how we can manipulate AI, you know. So as I say, to talk about this subject is about so many things, and there are so many things about data, about trust, about how we can just one picture that can just fool the whole system, right? So. They know what it is, they know how. So this is why they are the ones who are given those warnings, I think. Yeah, for the other side, the other question is about politics. Yes, true. I can't talk about everything, you know. About politics, yes. So for Trump, for example, you remember Trump, US elections and so on? They were tuned, Hillary or... So it's AI behind. And it was tuned, it wasn't real, it was biased, it was... Okay, and of course I can't include everything in the slides, but Macron, France, he said that he will ban Facebook and so on. It is serious, yes, he just mentioned it a few weeks ago. So that's real politics, yes, we can take it in either in our side or the other side. The other thing, and the other dangerous thing, is that, I didn't say it before, but with AI, you know that we can create some contents, either text, videos, and photos that are fake. AI can create that. They are fake, and we just believe that they are real. With AI, I can have myself somewhere, and everybody will believe it, and this is really dangerous. And this is the bad side of AI. As I said, so we need ethics. Everything is about ethics.
First, I would like to thank Mrs. Benbrahim for this enlightening presentation. I have two questions. The first one is, what I understood is all about automation. So my wonder, my scary is about, what about the workforce feeling towards companies? I will be restricted to job market. What about the workforce feeling towards companies? What about emotional investment to promote companies? Because we know that emotional investment leads to promotion of companies and in business. So when AI fill this gap of feelings, of emotions? First question. Second, the data. Can we indulge this in the data? Can we indulge feelings in the data we give, we provide for AI? Thank you.
Yes. So I'll start by the second question. Do you mean that can we just introduce female in the data? Yes, so data is biased. They just take, for example, all male and few portion of female. And we know that most of algorithms are just feelings. Sentiments, yes. So we're having sentiment analysis, we're having opinion mining, so we're having even with emails from your email, so we can detect. So IBM was only just doing that few years already from your email, so we can just detect if you're happy, if you're not, if you're stressed, if you're, yes. So it already exists, and IBM is having just a nice robot, you know, that is called Pepper. You know, he just talks to you, so it's all AI, you know, it's robots, it's machine learning, it's NLP, it's chatbot, it's everything. And when he talks to you, you know, he just look at you with his eyes and with the smile and with hands, and it's already there. Feelings are already there. So just Google Pepper, and it's really amazing. And Watson, also IBM, is there for feelings, it's already there, already. First question? Yeah. For employees. So they said yes, they are scared because AI will just take their jobs. But your point is that so AI will just relieve people from the repetitive tasks, for the things that are just easy to do and things, and so that the employees would just leave that time, you know, for more maybe brainstorming, for may thinking, for strategies and so on. So we are relieving employees from some tasks, but we are asking them to learn new skills, you know, that may just help them, you know. Yeah. Okay, so thank you, everybody.
Thank you again, Madame Benbrahim, for your presentation. Now we move on to our second guest. He is the director of LMI Morocco, one of the largest and greatest companies in organizational and personal help. Mr. Ktani is joining us here today, and he is going to give us a speech under the title Les 10 compétences clés de demain. Let us all welcome Mr. Hassan Ktani.
Thank you. Thank you. Would you mind I continue in English? Everybody's comfortable with English? Okay, so I continue in English so that you are used to it. My name is Hassan Ktani. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you very much for being here today. I shared some of my educational background with Huda at the beginning, so I was very happy to see her today. So we studied in the same university back in the, I won't say the date. Okay, so I'm an engineer in software engineering, so IT is my field. I worked in IT for 15 years and then I switched back to something else. At my sophomore year of my studies, I got a full scholarship in the University of Ottawa for a PhD. And I was about to pursue this, and at some time I met a professor, Huda knows him, he's called Dr. Rashidi Tajdin. I was a good student of him, and I asked him, he told me what you are doing next. I told him, okay, I have this scholarship that I was accepted, and maybe I will do it. And he told me something, never do it. Don't go for a PhD. So it was strange for him, and he gave me some arguments that were sound to me at that time. And later I discovered why that was important to have options. I don't say it was a good or bad advice. It has nothing to do with good or bad. It has to do with having more options in life. And later in life I discovered that personal development is having options in life. Don't ever think that you have only one option in your life. So what I'm sharing with you today is not an advice. It's not telling you what to do, what skills you will have to do, what study you will have to do, whether you will go for doing a PhD or go to that job market. It's not about that. Indeed, there is no solution for this. There is no right and wrong thing. But what we will discover today is about having more options and knowing the right thing at the right time. Okay, so this is our expectations. If anybody is expecting to have solutions today, sorry to deceive you. So what I'm doing now, I'm now at managing director of LMI, Leadership Management International. We are a company that's present in 80 countries now. We've worked with 2 million people around the world, helping them achieve a certain level of success in their lives in different languages. We work with different companies in Morocco. We exist in Morocco since 6 years now, and we have a different type of companies we worked with. What I want to share with you today, the main questions that we are approaching in our business are two questions. So the first question is, it's in French there, and I will explain it in English. Why do some people with extraordinary capabilities and skills have very little results in their life? And why other people with very basic skills achieve a lot of things? Huh? A lot of those people that Professor Huda said and mentioned names of the heads of big companies are not genius people. They are just like everybody. Some of them have very ordinary IQs and had very ordinary backgrounds. And the second question that we answer is why some people always seem to be at the right time and doing the right thing, and some people always seem to be at the wrong time doing the wrong thing. So why people have success in their life and why people accumulate failures in their lives? So what are the skills behind this? Can we learn this? Is it something we can control, or just we are born with those skills? So this is what our company is doing. We are helping professionals mainly, and also individuals, but mainly professionals, to uncover and work on those skills. And this is the why, or the how to do this. In this talk, we won't cover all these things. I will just, this is was supposed to be the last slide of this talk, is the World Economic Forum is suggesting, is through many studies, telling us what are the skills for, or the 10 most important skills that will be, that are we having now or a year earlier, what are trending in 4 years from now, and what are the skills that are declining. So you see obviously that all the skills in the first column are the skills related. What do you see the common denominator of those skills? What is your observation? analytical thinking, problem solving, thinking also, learning, creativity, attention to detail, emotional intelligence, reasoning, leadership, coordination. What are those skills? Yeah? Yeah? They are internal skills. Skills that are nothing to do with techniques. The skills that are declining are manual labor, verbal, management of finance, technology, installation, maintenance, reading, writing, language skills, management, quality control, coordination, visual, technology use. Those are very technical skills and they are declining, which means there are less and less room for them and more room for what is internal. So, a lot of you will say, okay, that's good, so I will go learning those skills and they will be fine. Is it true? Do you think it's true? Okay, we will answer this another time with some statistics. So, people, do you think that people that are out there in the job market having either those skills or those skills are happy doing what we are doing? If you go out in the world, not only in Morocco, do you think people are happy in their work environment? Who thinks they are very happy? Nobody. One person. Who thinks they are, let's say, averagely happy? Okay? Who thinks they are not happy? Nobody. A lot of people are not happy there. Okay. Great. So there is a study done by the state of Gallup, you know, the international firm Gallup. They are very famous for doing market research. And they did the state of the global workplace. You can find those statistics in the report. It's available online. And they said, okay, according to 12 questions, we will ask people, are they happy? They are all qualified people. They are working in firms in Morocco and abroad in 180 countries. And they asked them the following question. 12 questions, I won't say them, but the main thing is, are you happy or not happy with what you are doing? So they found there are three categories of people. People that are engaged. They are really owners of their company. They feel that this is their house. They love what they are doing. They switch off the light when they go. So they feel they are, it's their place. Okay? So that's the first category. The second category, non-engaged. They just show up because they have to show up. It's a job. They are paid, they have to work, so they are there. But they are doing only what is required. They don't go beyond this. Okay? A lot of people know these categories. Okay? The third category is the actively disengaged people. There are people, not only they are not happy, but they are inciting others to be not happy. So whenever you stop with, oh, that's bad, these are bad things, c'est pas bien, etc. Donc, they are always complaining, always think bad things about people, so they are provoking a negative feeling about people. So, what do you think the percentages, before giving you the percentages, what do you think, engagé, désengagé, activement désengagé, what do you think about the percentages of those? 80%, ok. Ok. Engagé.
Et puis les autres
80% non engagés. Ok. We will see the statistics. Ok. So, in the world, we will speak about the world. It's not very different in Morocco. 50% are engaged. They are fine, they are very happy. 67%, as said, are non-engaged. They are just there because they have to be there. And 80% are really giving hard time for other people to live, okay? With different
percentages according to countries. So you see what is here, United States and North Africa. We will see according to professions. So managers, executives, and people in the top really are more happier than people at the bottom. That's obvious. Okay. But there is a large population of them also are not engaged. And teachers also are mostly engaged, huh? But most of them are disengaged or actively disengaged. And it goes down here with the more difficult your job is. Okay, let's see what's happening in country by country. Same trend, most people are disengaged, okay? Non-engaged is dangerous because you don't feel good when you are working, and that's unproductive, and that's unhealthy, and that means you don't have results. Okay, that means you are most of your time in a job that doesn't mean anything, and if you find better, you go. That's not a situation where we go. We want to be. Huh? Let's see what's happening in Morocco. I gathered four countries, and in Morocco, it's not that worse. Huh? We have more people engaged than in Japan. That's good. So engaged doesn't mean they do good or bad work. It means what's inside them. Okay? So even if the environment is different, we find people that are engaged. But we have the largest percentage of people in those countries, which is very disengaged, actively disengaged, which means it breaks the others, okay? And we have the people in the middle are half of the people are in the middle, but we have really extremes in that. We have people pulling from this side and people from that. Okay, so why I'm doing those statistics? Just to tell you, whatever skill you study, whatever soft skill or technical skill you have, most likely will end be somewhere in the middle of people not engaged. And this is what we don't want to have this. So it doesn't matter what you study, it doesn't matter what has your job, it doesn't matter what you work on. Ending up here or here is something we don't want. And this is what this educational system is giving us. This is what the world is giving us. So we have the choice to choose to do whatever we want, to study whatever we want, and ending up for the rest of our lives being among the population here, worse here. And if you have by chance or by work some skills, you can be here. So what's the factor that helps us determine where we are? What do you think? It's a question. The first question, do you want to be disengaged or actively disengaged? Nobody. Nobody will want this, okay? So how do you think we can act on this? Let's see why it is like this, okay? These are the skills. Let's have some history, okay? You know, we started the modern history. Industry, there are four levels of industry. This is common knowledge. The first one was 1.0, it's the invention of the machine. So the 2.0, mass production. Then 3.0, the automation. We started having a mechanism and reflex. And 4.0 is what we see now, Internet of Things, artificial intelligence. And it starts moving very, very rapidly. So you see in only 40 years or 50 years, we did two revolutions. And now it's starting to be more and more rapid and fast. So what's happening in an educational system is different. How we learn things wasn't as fast as how we are improving. So this is what happens in the United States, and you can find it everywhere. But this is the United States. You see that from from 1600 they're starting to have some form of organized education, like starting to have nurseries, people that are taking care of small children, and then they evolved to some schools with classes, then they evolved to committees of what we call now class. So 120 years ago, we have the form of school we have now. And during 100 years, or now 120 years, we didn't have much happening in classrooms. So when we come now, and you come 100 years ago, you find always a classroom, you find a professor, you find tests, you will find a subject taught, and you find people learning. There was not much difference in the way we teach people. So do you see anything going wrong here? What's going on? C'est quoi le problème? The problem is, you don't see any problem from here to here? This changed so rapidly, and this didn't change. This change, the skills needed are changing. Okay? The jobs are changing, the way we are doing business. However, what we learned didn't change much. How we learned didn't change much. And this creates the statistics you saw, okay? Actually, this way of learning was created to serve those type of industries. Why people did classrooms and gathered people in the same way? That's because they needed them for mass production. So they designed a system to produce people to work here. The system evolved. So now we have it, but we have other forms that are prominent. However, what we teach people didn't evolve much. So we're having people that are not happy with their life. They are not producing, okay? They are not having results. And the end, they didn't achieve anything. Do you agree with this? Okay. No, I'm not thinking it's the cause. It's one. I'm saying what we are teaching didn't evolve much. Okay, I'll arrive at this. Okay, so now I will speak about the what I want to say. What I want to say, though, there is no solution, no direct solution for what you saw as statistics. What I want to say is that this is an iceberg, that the human being has a lot of capabilities. We have the conscious mind and the unconscious mind. What the education actually is giving us, it's giving us conscious information. Okay, what we are working on hardly and giving a lot of energy is what happens here, of the conscious mind. We want people to know how to work, how to speak, how to produce machines, how to produce accounting. That's good, that's fine, that's very, very productive. However, is it enough? No, because 90% of what we are is unconscious mind, how we feel, how we treat others, do we respect others, do we love others, do we want the good for us and for the others, how we work together in a team. Okay, these are another type of skills that are 90% of what we are, because unconscious mind, how we think, the way we think, makes up 90% of who we are. It's our conditioning, it's the way we live. So we are producing people since 100 years, focusing on what happens in our minds, how we learn, and forgetting 90% of who we are, which is how we think, how we produce things, and how we why we live and how we live. So what happens also that we have less results with more efforts. The more we are investing in this, the less we are getting results and the less people are motivated in their work because we are not taking part of what matters. So to go back to the skills, why this is trending, for two reasons. One, you already saw in the first presentation, because life is changing. And that's only one reason. The other reason is because people, in doing advancement in technology, they are not happier. They are less happy. They are less happy and they have less results in the goals. So they are now turning around to find skills that make them produce more results in their lives. And this is why you see leadership with our reasoning, problem solving, emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence has nothing to do with what we learn. It's how we work together. So they are now putting more focus on those skills. What you call now, it's more complex than soft skills. It's more, so what I'm saying now is not giving you a receipt of how to succeed in life, but telling you, you have to invest in yourself, in your skills, internal skills, let's say as much as you invest in your technical skills, maybe more, because those skills are making you, giving you the results of the person you will be tomorrow. Okay, let's go a little bit deeper. We have in LMI what we call the wheel of life. We did a model of life that has six areas, which are spiritual and ethic, family, fitness, finance, mental, educational, and health, and social and cultural. Okay? So, this model of life means what? Means fixing goals in each area of life, having scales on each area of life, and achieving those goals makes you the person you want to be. We have to be conscious that the model of life is different than what maybe we have in our brains. So most people are putting a lot of energy in one of these areas and forgetting about the others. What the new skills that we are speaking about suggesting that the model of life should be changing. A lot of people say, why people are doing more sports now? Why we have a lot of things going on in intellectual things? Because the model of life we've been working on since a long time is having very, very limited results on the motivation. So what we are suggesting now is that in the way we receive information, in education, in the workplace, in the family, in the ways we are receiving life, the model of life should take into consideration that our goals are larger than what we might think. The model of life, we can have another, as I'm speaking now to young children, your goals, something that I never studied in university or in school. Nobody spoke to me until very late in my career about goals, about how to set a goal. Why you want this job? Everybody was speaking about this job is good, this job is bad, this job provides more opportunities. Okay, but what about me? What is my goal? Okay. Yeah. Yeah, bien sûr.
Population.
Oui, tout à fait. Bien sûr.
Il influence tout ça. Physique, la santé aussi.
Bonne question.
La troisième dimension permet de voir le noir.
Exactement. C'est un modèle en 2D. Alors, la roue de la vie, c'est un modèle en 2D qui modélise la vie. Ça ne veut pas dire qu'il n'y a pas de transition. Tous les aspects sont liés aux autres. Maintenant, on considère une action dans un domaine lorsque la plupart de ce qu'on fait, il est dans son domaine. Ça veut dire, étudier, c'est dans le mental et intellectuel. Malgré que étudier peut... Et dans le carrière. Maintenant, lorsqu'on est dans la mosquée, c'est clairement du spirituel. Lorsqu'on fait de l'éducation physique, maintenant, il y a des interactions. Mais la roue de la vie, elle est faite pour modéliser les activités. Ça ne veut pas dire qu'il n'y a pas d'interaction. Il y a de l'interaction. C'est très central. OK? Donc, le modèle de la vie, ou the wheel of life, help us. Exactement. Donc, what we are suggesting, and especially for our students, what we saw is very perfect. What you are learning is excellent. What you will do as a job after you graduate, it doesn't depend on how the world is doing. It depends mostly on you as a person. So what we are suggesting as a model that you can help yourself choosing the right answer, because nobody will give you the right answer. It's just a waste of time asking people what works. Is setting your mission. Mission is very complex to set it. Okay, what you want to achieve in this life. How to set a mission is just your values and your dreams. Do you dream of being something? Yeah, write it down. Do you have some values like achievement, like happiness, like money, like anything? Write those values and come up with something that's interesting, that's worth your life, okay? After that, what are the challenges? Okay, I want to have a lot of money. I want to travel. Translate the challenges to goals. So I want in 1 year to finish my diploma, in 2 years to have a job, a good job, in 5 years to travel or to say something. It's something timed, with time, with amounts, okay? And then translate this to actions that you put in your daily schedule. This is the formula we've been working 50 years for people to succeed. What happens is if you do this, you will find that what you do in the day is in line with what you want. Most people that forget this formula, what they do? Their challenges, goals, and mission is somewhere, and what they are doing is somewhere else. And they can't keep doing this, and what happens of this is suffering, not being happy, all the statistics you saw. This is the reason, because we are not asking the good question. The good question is what salary is not what job is good for 1922, no. The good question is what I want to do as a my contribution to this world and to myself, and in which field I want to have it, and how to know this. So it's slightly different to what personally I had. I wished 20 years ago somebody told me this. I wished somebody insisted on this. It wasn't that clear because a lot of things could change when you take the right approach. And I'm not saying about the right decision, but the right way of thinking. So when your plan of action is from your goals, you start achieving things in your life. You start seeing results. And in the process, you are happy because you are in line of what you said to yourself as career. So my advice, take some time to start this. And as a first exercise, I think all of you have some pieces of papers, yeah? Okay? You have? So,
Because everything we do is practical. We hate speeches. In LMI, we hate speeches. We hate a lot of talk. We want to be practical. So let's say now we are the 2nd of April, 2019. Let's project ourselves 20 years from now, okay? So students will be different from professor, but you write. And start by writing your goal in 10 years and in 20 years. Where, what is your job you are doing 10 years? That's 10 years and 20 years. The job you are doing 10 years from now, the salary with dirhams of today. Okay, we'll take only two aspects. There are a lot of aspects, but we'll take only two. Okay, which are important. What we are doing and how, what money we have. That's, most of people are interested in those things. There are other things, of course. So just write, without any name, just write to me, I will be a software engineer, I will be professor, I will be a head of Dr. Saeed in 10 years, don't tell him. I will be something. What is that your job? How do you introduce it? Yeah, you can write it. Yeah, yeah, of course, that's good, that's important, because this is... Yeah, you have to write, je serai retraité et je serai dans tel endroit. Je veux faire quelque chose. Retraité, il est en train de faire quelque chose. Hein. Vous avez un objectif. Une nouvelle vie. Ben, comment elle est cette nouvelle vie? Comment vous l'imaginez? Donc, just a goal to achieve. And after that, if you want a revenue, targeted revenue, by month, in dirhams of today. Don't project yourself. 20 years, maybe the dirham will disappear. But in dirhams of today, let's say, je suis en deuxième année maintenant. Dans dix années, je veux être chef de département dans une société privée et je gagne 20 000 dirhams avec les dirhams d'aujourd'hui, ou 20, ou 30, ou 40, ou 50. Write something realistic that you can achieve and that you think you can achieve. And project yourself 20 years from now. You'll find this exercise very interesting and very difficult at the same time. Let's just start thinking about this, and 5 minutes, I will give you 5 minutes to decide. Don't write your name, just because the purpose is not... Yes, it's good. Je vais rester là. Ok, très bien. D'accord, donc je vais parler en français les deux. Ok, très bien. Oui, c'est bien. Qu'est-ce que vous allez faire pour être grand-mère? Donc il faut... Très bien, très bien. Et pour vous, qu'est-ce que vous allez faire, vous voulez faire pour votre vie? Comment vous allez passer votre journée? Voilà, ça c'est un objectif. Donc qu'est-ce qu'il faut faire maintenant pour publier le roman? Vous voyez, ça déclenche quelque chose, ça déclenche une réflexion et puis... Donc, vous commencez à faire des actions. Ouais. Goal, c'est objectif. Objectif, votre objectif. Challenge, c'est le défi. Le challenge, c'est écrire un roman. L'objectif, c'est écrire un roman dans 5 ans, avec 500 pages, oui. Déterminé dans le temps et dans le périmètre. Plan d'action, c'est qu'est-ce que je veux faire maintenant? Je vais acheter un ordinateur, après je commence choisir le sujet ou se documenter. Donc qu'est-ce que vous allez faire maintenant? Ok? Who did it? Who fixed this goal? Ok? So, comment vous sentez? Qu'est-ce qui se passe dans vos têtes lorsque vous êtes en train de écrire? Oui, comment? On est heureux déjà. Encore stressé. Oui? Pourquoi vous êtes stressé? D'accord. Parce que lorsque vous écrivez un objectif, qu'est-ce qui se passe? C'est un engagement. On a peur de l'action. Madame a dit, ah bon, par exemple, pour écrire un roman, je dois probablement changer de travail. Hein? Bon, changer de travail, ça c'est dangereux. Ou prendre le temps. Donc à chaque fois, on est dans le processus d'écrire un objectif, on est dans l'action, dans le changement et dans l'action. La motivation. Oui. On est motivé. Et la motivation, qu'est-ce qu'elle va faire? Elle va générer un engagement, elle va générer de l'action. Donc tout commence par fixer un objectif. Donc, la fixation d'objectif, c'est vous que vous déterminez l'objectif au début, mais après, le moment où vous avez écrit votre objectif et votre revenu, le processus inverse commence. Ça veut dire que c'est l'objectif qui prend la main et vous commencez à exécuter les actions nécessaires. Si vous êtes motivé, c'est vraiment votre objectif. Je donne un exemple très simple. Vous voyagez, il y a des vacances dans 2 mois par exemple. Il n'y a pas d'objectif, donc on ne fait rien. Imaginez que vous avez fixé comme objectif de partir aux États-Unis dans 2 mois. Qu'est-ce qui va commencer aujourd'hui? Tout va changer. Hein. Vous avez commencé à étudier, à prendre le visa, à réserver l'avion, à imaginer à mettre de l'épargne pour la... Donc vous avez commencé à exécuter, à faire des actions. Et c'est ça qu'on veut... C'est ça le secret de la fixation d'objectifs. Ça transforme votre vie à l'action plutôt non-action. Donc lorsque vous fixez comme professeur, c'est un objectif, vous commencez dès aujourd'hui à réaliser votre objectif et à imaginer des solutions à le faire. Lorsque vous... Oui? Oui? Réaliste, oui. Oui, c'est à ce niveau. Les challenges, les rêves. Les rêves sont au niveau de mission et au niveau du défi. Maintenant, vos rêves doivent avoir des manifestations réalistes maintenant. Je rêve de... Donnez-moi un rêve que vous aviez. Bien sûr. Exactement, c'est pour cela qu'il y a ce lien entre le défi ou le rêve qui est ici, ou le défi qui est ici, et l'objectif. L'objectif doit être réaliste, smart. Le rêve n'est pas réaliste. Mais le rêve, comment on l'exécute? À travers un objectif réaliste. Ça veut dire, l'humanité avait un rêve de partir vers la Lune, d'accord? Mais quel est l'objectif? C'était dans 10 ans, par exemple, pouvoir voler déjà. Et pouvoir construire des... Donc c'est des choses réalistes, cumulées, nous donnent l'accès à un rêve qui est là. Donc en fait, le rêve, c'est l'origine. Les gens qui ne rêvent pas ne réalisent rien du tout. Et les gens conformistes qui rêvent toujours des... Vous allez remarquer que lorsqu'on est petit, on rêve plus. On a des objectifs qui sont ambitieux. Le plus on est en vie, le plus nos objectifs descendent. Et si on regarde maintenant les niveaux de revenus, vous allez trouver que les petits, les jeunes, ils ont des rêves beaucoup plus grands. Et lorsqu'on est un peu âgé, on limite un petit peu nos rêves. Voire il n'y a plus... c'est pas forcément. parce que notre machine à rêver a été détruite. Ce n'est pas parce qu'on est réaliste, parce que durant notre parcours, nos exigences ont baissé. Notre machine à rêver qui fonctionnait très bien lorsqu'on est né, on a fait en sorte qu'on a détruit cette machine. Et du coup, on ne rêve plus. D'accord ? Malgré que c'est pas vrai. Hein. On a eu des gens à 50 ans, à 60 ans, changer le monde. Hein. Et ils sont partout. Ouais. Oui, c'est nous qu'on a limité nos rêves. C'est de l'autodestruction. C'est nous-mêmes qu'on a construit autour de nos rêves ou nos objectifs des plafonds. Des plafonds fictifs. Hein, parce que le potentiel humain il est limité. On possède plus de capacités qu'on avait à 20 ans, mais moins de rêves. Paradoxalement, vous connaissez plus actuellement, tous. Vous connaissez plus, vous êtes mieux outillés. Souvent, vous avez plus d'accès à l'argent et à lorsqu'on était 20 ans. Mais paradoxalement, on a envie de faire moins de choses. C'est un paradoxe. Hein? On est mieux outillés, moins ambitieux. D'accord? Pourquoi? Parce qu'on a, durant ces années, on a limité nos rêves, nos objectifs par ce qu'on voit, ce qu'on réalise. Et c'est réversible, la bonne nouvelle. La bonne nouvelle, c'est réalisable, ça veut dire que vous pouvez commencer aujourd'hui. Vous avez 20 ans, vous avez 40 ans, vous avez 45 ans, vous commencez aujourd'hui à fixer des objectifs et la machine commence à tourner. Oui. Oui, lorsqu'on n'a pas d'objectif, tout simplement. Lorsqu'on n'a pas d'objectif, c'est tout simple. Tout simplement, ça c'est bon. Ah, wow. Tout simplement, lorsqu'on arrête de fixer des objectifs comme vous venez de faire tous, je vous félicite parce que maintenant vous avez la première verse, vous avez écrit votre futur. Hein? Vous avez écrit votre futur actuellement. Donc tout ce que vous avez écrit dans vos feuilles, c'est votre futur. Donc lorsque vous commencez à travailler, est-ce que ça c'est suffisant ou pas? C'est pas suffisant parce que la prochaine étape, c'est de commencer à exécuter, c'est de faire un plan d'action pour arriver à vos objectifs. Rappelez-vous bien de vos objectifs, parce que vous êtes en train d'écrire votre futur, parce que l'attitude de fixer des objectifs, c'est une attitude qui vous aide à réaliser, qui vous aide à être la version de vous-même que vous voulez être, plutôt que la version de vous-même qui est un cumul de ce que vous avez vécu. D'accord. On va analyser quelques feuilles pour tout à l'heure. Ok. Alors donc le mot de la fin, c'est en fait Paul G. Meyer, le fondateur LMI, a dit tout ce que vous imaginez avec vivacité, désirez ardemment, croyez sincèrement et travaillez avec enthousiasme doit inévitablement finir par arriver. Donc l'acteur principal. Durant 50 ans, on a travaillé avec les gens. L'acteur principal dans le changement, c'est pas l'environnement. C'est pas l'économie, c'est l'être humain. C'est ce que vous possédez à l'intérieur de vous plutôt que ce qui se passe à l'extérieur. Et la bonne nouvelle, c'est que vous avez tous, quel que soit votre âge, votre niveau, vous avez la capacité à agir sur votre avenir pour être la personne que vous voulez être. Voilà, donc ça c'est un résumé de développement personnel, si vous voulez. Et un appel à prendre l'action sur votre avenir. Merci beaucoup. Je suis à vous si vous avez des questions. Est-ce qu'il y a des questions?
If you have any questions, please feel free.
تفضل استاذ
Je vous demande en français ou en...
La langue que vous êtes français.
En français. Je veux revenir à... I think I prefer to ask in English, I'm sorry. I prefer to ask in English if you don't mind.
Ask in English.
Yes, all right. I just would like to go back to what you said about being engaged and disengaged and the percentages you gave. One thing that I found striking is that when you compared, for example, Morocco and Japan, when you compared Morocco and Japan, when the statistics. Now, when you ask, and the majority, Morocco compared to, for example, Japan, a lot are actively disengaged. Yeah? Or the majority are engaged.
Yeah.
Although they which means that they more or less like their jobs. They're not very happy, but they're okay. Now, when, and the others are actively engaged. And again, the percentage shows that Morocco have the highest percentage in concerning people who are actively disengaged.
Yeah.
Now, when you ask people, and I have experience with people, and they say, most of them, they blame it on the salary.
Yeah.
They say, well, I don't like my job because I'm not well paid. So they are actively disengaged. They are not doing their job consciously, and they don't like their job, and they keep complaining, etc. And they blame it on the salary.
Yeah.
Now, if you go back to Japan, and again, those who are, you have the, again, the percentage shows that people who are happy with, they have the highest percentages. People who are engaged, which means that they have very good conditions.
Yeah.
However, when you look at Japan, they have the highest percentage of suicide.
Yeah.
Now, just from my experience, I was once in Japan, and one of the things that really I found striking among hundreds of people, I told my daughter, everybody looks unhappy. That was really, really striking me, apart from all the positive aspects, but that's something really striking. Now, I can tell you that we were three among hundreds of people. We are the only ones who were making jokes and laughing. And so which means that just to go back to the statistics, people who say, well, I blame it on the salary, which is not true. Because you can earn a lot, but that won't make of you a happy person. And this is just for people, Moroccans, they don't realize this. So it's not, it has nothing to do with the salary or with the, it's really
the inside.
The quality of life, I would say.
Yeah.
Because when you go abroad and you come back, the quality of life is, regardless of the work conditions, and the quality of life is what makes people in Morocco happier.
Yeah, you are absolutely right. You find in the statistics 6% only the people that are actively engaged. You find a lot of people are doing their job, but they are doing their job. So what we discovered, this is something very important. The environment doesn't make you. You make the environment. And the environment doesn't make you happy or unhappy. You decide for yourself, regardless of the environment. So, not because you are in Japan or in the United States, you will be happier than in Morocco. That has nothing to do. It's you decide what part of the environment makes you happy, and you decide for yourself what makes you happy, and you decide to be happy or not to be happy. So it's an effect of, it's in, out, not out in. The statistics are very similar in terms of happiness, of regardless of you are having a lot of money or less money. So it's another time. It's what happens inside you. It's your goals. It's your expectations. It's your interaction with the others that makes you the person you want to be. Okay? Yeah. It's not because you have a very big salary you'll be happy. That's false. That's false. Not, it's not,
not because you live in Japan or the United States or Norway, you'll be happy, or in Morocco, or not because you are living in Morocco, you won't be happy, or you have less chance than somebody in Japan. That's you decide of this. You have less chance because you decided to have less chance. It's not because of the other, it's because of us. So we live in, let's say, a collective world, but each of us lives in his own world that he's doing from his own experiences and his own goals. That's very, very important. Yes. So people looking for happiness outside of them, they are looking in that wrong place.
All
right.
Okay. Maintenant, les statistiques, il faut toujours les prendre avec des pincettes, sincèrement, parce que lorsqu'on me dit que les Japonais sont engagés à 6%, les Marocains à 20%, c'est faux. C'est faux. Pourquoi ? Parce que si on revient à la nature de l'engagement, c'est comme pour le suicide. Le suicide fait partie de la culture des Japonais aussi. C'est-à-dire, l'ultime sacrifice pour la nation, ce n'est pas à Harakiri, comme vous le savez un peu. Pour nous, le suicide, c'est vraiment désobéissance tout ça, ça reste vraiment. Maintenant, par rapport aux entreprises, on prend les États-Unis, le Maroc et le Japon. Déjà, qu'est-ce qui motive par rapport à la motivation, au niveau management? Vous avez l'engagement des Américains, c'est par rapport à leur fonction. Ça, c'est connu, c'est par rapport à leur fonction. Aujourd'hui, ils sont nés ici, ils sont nés pour être nés ici. Demain, ils sont financiers, ils vont s'engager pour eux. Donc, tout ce qui est arbitrage au niveau des entreprises change complètement parce que la personne, elle croit à sa fonction. Ça n'a pas été éliminé, sa légitimité vient parce qu'on lui a donné des belles fonctions. Les Japonais, ils s'engagent pour leur entreprise. Donc c'est un engagement d'une autre manière, c'est-à-dire ils ne font pas de grève, même s'ils ont des conditions qui ne leur plaisent pas, ils ne font pas de grève. Parce que pour eux, un Japonais, le pire malheur qui arrive à un Japonais, c'est d'appartenir à une entreprise en faillite. Okay? Nous autres Marocains, je parle des Marocains, des Africains, des Méditerranéens, on croit à l'esprit de clan, à l'esprit de chef. C'est-à-dire, il y a un mimétisme. Si le chef est engagé, moi aussi je suis engagé. Et en général, dès qu'on est recruté, on regarde, on trouve un bon chef et on le suit. Plus on travaille le chef monte, plus moi aussi je monte. Donc en fait, c'est un engagement d'une autre manière. Dans les 20%, c'est parce qu'il y a du suivisme.
Ouais.
Donc voilà, il y a d'autres dimensions. C'est comment on voit l'entreprise, ou bien l'organisation, ou l'administration. Et comment on va s'engager. C'est-à-dire, nous, c'est un engagement de tribu. Parce qu'on est une société tribale, on est en société. C'est-à-dire, on va quand même en groupe. Et maintenant, il faudra choisir le meilleur. Ouais. Ça, c'est simplement
la lecture.
Maintenant, pour ce qui est. Je souscris tout à fait à votre. Vous avez un schéma, timeline, qui s'arrête en 2000. C'est vrai. Parce qu'à partir de 2000 aux États-Unis, il y a eu le commencement de ce qu'on appelle l'université de troisième génération. Où il n'y a pas que l'enseignement et la recherche, il y a l'enseignement, la recherche et la valorisation économique. C'est-à-dire que le professeur n'est pas simplement qu'un professeur, celui qui professe, qui est dans la vérité. C'est un professeur, c'est un scientifique aussi qui fait de la recherche, mais c'est un entrepreneur. Où les objectifs ne sont pas nationaux, ce sont des objectifs globaux, global dans le monde. Et la langue d'enseignement, c'est l'anglais. Donc ça, c'est la troisième génération. Malheureusement, il y a beaucoup. Malheureusement pour nous, on n'a pas encore ça, mais il y a beaucoup de pays africains qui se sont engagés dans cette voie-là. On parle toujours du Rwanda, de l'Ouganda, etc. et ça se voit rapidement sur le ranking, sur le classement. Pourquoi? Parce qu'ils ont inscrit l'entrepreneuriat, les soft skills, le fait de transformer la connaissance en argent. Alors on parle de tmin, le mérifa, imagine, c'est le mérifa, c'est-à-dire c'est de l'argent qui peut être utilisé pour donner une plus d'indépendance à l'université, etc., etc. Ils ont traduit ça en réalité. Donc moi je souscris parfaitement à ce que vous avez dit, et sincèrement je vous remercie parce qu'il y a des idées qui sont très très intéressantes. Malheureusement tous les profs ne sont pas là, mais on peut s'en inspirer de, pleinement. Merci,
merci. Merci beaucoup. Bon, les étudiants, si vous avez une question. Il y avait une question
considère le deux tiers de notre cerveau. Et le fait de dire que, qu'il faut toujours...
Concernant la diapositive de la conscience et l'inconscience, vous avez dit qu'il faut toujours travailler l'inconscience parce qu'elle considère le deux tiers de notre raison. Et il faut se focaliser sur l'inconscience que plutôt sur la conscience. Ma question c'est comment peut-on se focaliser sur l'inconscience si la conscience est la seule méthode d'arriver à l'inconscience. Ma deuxième question c'est sur la dernière diapositive, je pense, vous avez dit qu'on doit citer nos objectifs avant de... qu'il faut citer les objectifs pour bien être organisé. Mais citer les objectifs, ça commençait à être pour moi une monotonie. Je commence toujours à citer mes objectifs, mais le fait de faire la quatrième étape, c'est ça, je pense, la plus grande, la plus importante étape. Parce que le fait de réaliser, de transformer les objectifs en action, c'est plus difficile. Et le fait de commencer même, je peux dire, par exemple, je vais être un ingénieur comme ça ou quelque chose comme ça, et le fait de travailler même les objectifs étape par étape, ça commence bien, on est toujours motivé dès le début, mais ça reste toujours descendant. Et, on n'arrive pas, j'arrive pas, en fait, à continuer mes objectifs, à arriver à les réaliser. Oui.
Donc les deux questions, rapidement, comment agir sur l'inconscient, comment agir sur l'inconscient, sachant qu'on a la main surtout sur le conscient. Et la deuxième, c'est on commence beaucoup de choses et on s'arrête au bout de la route. Donc en fait, la portail de l'inconscient, c'est le conscient. Je vous donne un exemple du sport. Donc le conscient, c'est quand lorsque vous êtes en train d'apprendre de jouer par exemple le tennis, et vous vous dites, bon, faites comme ça. D'accord. Donc les premiers mouvements sont très difficiles. Le fait en fait de sport, c'est pas de vous apprendre de faire le mouvement, c'est que votre réflexe, c'est lui qui fait le mouvement. Vous avez le réflexe. Aucun joueur dans le monde, aucun praticien ne réfléchit, bon, je dois frapper la balle comme ça, je dois nager comme ça. Non, ça ne se passe pas comme ça. Vous passez à travers votre conscient pour faire les premiers mouvements et vous avez fait la répétition espacée des milliers de fois pour que ça devienne un réflexe. Et là, vous commencez à jouer le sport. D'accord ? Aucun joueur ne réfléchit. C'est lorsque votre réflexe devient les mouvements conscients. Ben, c'est la même chose exactement dans les attitudes. Ce qu'on fait à LMI, dans tous les programmes en général de développement personnel, c'est la notion de répétition espacée consciente des attitudes pour les impliquer ou pour induire l'inconscient à devenir un réflexe. Je vous donne un exemple. Bon, on réfléchit d'une manière... quand on réfléchit de manière négative et ça nous donne de mauvais résultats dans notre vie. On décide à un moment, là, ça nous donne un fixer des objectifs. Vous décidez maintenant, parce que vous êtes allé avec les gens, etc., vous ressortez, Alors, qu'est-ce qu'il faut faire? Alors, il faut faire de la répétition espacée. C'est ce qu'on fait dans le programme LMI. Ça veut dire quoi? Ça veut dire, bon, je décide d'adopter une attitude, ben, je vais dire, ben, je ne vais pas adopter ça une semaine, c'est très difficile pour moi. Une semaine, on a... Donc, je le fais uniquement pendant 5 heures. Donc, 5 heures, je l'accepte. Je suis dans l'acceptation et dans le positivisme.
ben tu augmentes la dose. Et tu augmentes la dose, t'inquiète. Lorsque tu répètes ça des dizaines de fois, ça devient une attitude. Et là, vous avez le résultat. Donc, vous passez à l'inconscient à travers le conscient. Donc, à travers la répétition espacée et d'autres outils qu'on fait. Mais le plus important, c'est la répétition espacée du contenu. Pour que ce qu'on fait, le développement personnel et l'ennemi, on ne veut pas que vous connaissiez le comment faire, comment fixer des objectifs, comment... Ça existe. Mais les gens ne le font pas à l'âge. C'est comme le sport, on sait comment courir. Tout le monde sait comment courir. Mais très peu de gens réalisent des choses à l'âge. Ce n'est pas une habitude. Donc le passage de la connaissance, qui est inconsciente, à l'application et l'attitude qui est inconsciente, c'est ça en fait notre rôle. C'est pas l'information. Knowledge is not power. C'est faux. Knowledge is not power. Vous pouvez lire les livres que vous voulez. Vous voulez apprendre ce que vous voulez. Vous n'allez pas profiter de ça tant que ça ne devient pas une attitude plutôt qu'une connaissance. Mais tous les gens qui adhèrent au programme sont des gens connaisseurs. Hein. Les programmes ennemis sont connus, il y a certains qui ont passé par eux. Tous, c'est au niveau CEO, au niveau dirigeant d'entreprise, doyen de faculté, etc. C'est des gens qui connaissent 100% de ce qu'on dit. Aucune nouveauté. C'est quoi le problème? C'est qu'ils veulent que ça soit des attitudes. Ils ne veulent pas que ça soit des connaissances. Et c'est là le challenge. Donc, ça c'est la première partie. La deuxième partie, c'est en fait, on commence et on abandonne. Ben, bien sûr. On commence à abandonner pour deux raisons. Premièrement, parce que l'objectif n'est pas suffisamment motivant pour nous. Donc, on dit des choses qui sont pas, qu'on ne veut pas vraiment réaliser. On n'a pas vraiment envie de faire ça. C'est juste un objectif. Mais un objectif vrai, c'est lorsque c'est un vrai objectif. C'est quelque chose que vous êtes prêt à payer le prix. Parce que vous sentez que le non-atteint de cet objectif, il est dangereux pour vous. Donc lorsque vous êtes lié à cet objectif, quand vous êtes lié à l'eau, lorsque vous avez besoin d'eau, c'est là où vous commencez à faire les actions. Et petit à petit. Et par manque également de moyens, d'outils. Hein. Beaucoup de gens veulent réaliser des choses, mais ils ne sont pas outillés. Donc, ils ne savent pas faire. Bon, ils ne connaissent pas les objectifs, ils n'ont pas de plan d'action, ils ne savent pas. Outillés. Donc, c'est soit au niveau motivation, soit au niveau outillage. Donc, les deux sont très importants pour atteindre. Et, très bien.
All right. Thank you very much for your very insightful presentation again. Mr. Kteni, please applaud him very much. We've been here for quite a long period now, so it's time for a coffee break. We stop here and we rejoin again after 30 minutes. Thank you.